Talk about, as I said, talk about why it was so important to be in Huntsville, be at Lockheed Martin this week.
Well, we're doing the ribbon cutting for our next generation interceptor missile systems integration lab. This is a big step for us, a huge investment in the North Alabama region, $16.5 million that we've put in here to allow us to do the testing and the integration that we need to do for the next generation interceptor for the Missile Defense Agency. This is the system that's going to be the next protection against ballistic missiles coming into the U.S. So excited to be here. Another great investment from Lockheed, building off our 60 years of being here.
And of course, this is to stop intercontinental ballistic missiles.
Correct.
Lockheed does a lot in missile defense, and I know you must be involved in hypersonic, the work to create hypersonic, both defensive and offensive. Can you talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, we can keep it at a high level. We do work with the hypersonics. It's obviously a threat that we have to pay attention to as a nation, and our engagement there is just in like it is with all our engagements with the customers is, what is the threat? Let's see what we can do to build systems that allow that threat to be mitigated or deterred, honestly, from being used. So yeah, our teams are involved with that across the corporation.
Is it possible to ask you if you feel good about America's efforts in this respect? Because everybody acknowledges we fell behind during Iraq and Afghanistan.
I probably ought not go down that path.
Okay, well, I understand that. I mean, something.
That's more of the government gets to make that, right?
No, I totally get that. All right, you're in charge of space for Lockheed Martin, and you're used to being involved with space, but it's such a broad category now for any aerospace defense contractor, isn't it?
Yes, very much so. If you look at our particular mission that I have for Lockheed Martin Space, roughly 24,000 folks, if you think about that. We span the DoD, the intelligence community, and of course NASA and NOAA. Our moniker is Protect, Connect, and Explore. The Protect piece is things like we recognize this week with the NGI, the facility opening. We want to be able to protect not only our homeland, but our warfighters, and so we build systems that allow that. The connect piece is we build communication satellites and activities like that that the DoD uses that we want to be able to connect our warfighters when they need to. And explore, obviously, is things like Orion and the deep space exploration like OSIRIS-REx that we just got through doing. So it's a pretty broad portfolio,
yeah.
But the way space is going these days, I think everybody's space portfolio is pretty broad.
Yeah, and I don't think most people get that the Army, for instance, is the largest user of space in a space-faring country like the U.S.
Yeah, for the communications piece in particular and things like that they use, yeah.
Okay, so can't go without talking about manned space flight, with you especially. But let's talk about the thing Lockheed Martin is so involved in and is the Orion and the Artemis missions. Talk about the excitement level for a guy who's been around this for most of your career.
Yeah, it's really exciting, Steve. We have an opportunity, I think, to really set the legacy for the next generation. You know, they call it the Artemis generation.
Yeah.
Of course, on the Lockheed side, Lockheed Martin side, I am now, my team's responsible for Orion, the capsule that'll take the humans there and back. For me personally, it's an interesting experience. I'm a propulsion guy, if you think about it. You know, I was part of the early configurations and design and work on SLS when I was here at Marshall. So, going from a propulsion guy that loves rocket engines to loving parachutes. When those parachutes deploy, when we come back through the atmosphere, it's an amazing feeling of adrenaline. And you know, we did Artemis 1 with the 25 and a half day mission. I've never been so happy to see parachutes in my life, to see that capsule come home. And so we're super excited about Artemis 2 and the opportunity to go support that mission as well. So it's gonna be fun having the crew on board.
Okay, so the SLS guys at Marshall were just ecstatic about the way things work. Was the Orion reaction, did you feel like, hey, did what it was supposed to do?
Absolutely. We felt like we had a really good mission for the first mission going through. Typical, you know, what I would call tweaks and things we have to deal with, and now we're ready to move on. And so we've got the vehicle and the service module are stacked down at the Cape, and so we're getting through our testing and should be turning it over to the Kennedy Space Flight Center team, or Kennedy Space Center team.
Okay, so one of the things was with the public, why can't we launch next week? You know, we want to launch. As a space guy, is it too long, too short, the right amount of time to take between missions? Because I'm not sure that we like our gratification a little quicker than we're getting it right now.
I've never been driven by time so much, Steve. It's more, what are the requirements? What do we need to do to make sure that we take the crews up there and bring them back safely? So it's making sure we're hitting the milestones that we need to hit and making sure we're meeting the requirements that are put in place to protect the crew and make sure they get home. And that to me is more the issue.
Yeah.
I mean, everybody wants it to go faster. We know that, right? But we also have to make sure we're doing the right thing.
And just, that's a huge, the Orion, I mean, you know, the rockets and stuff. Yeah, that's one kind of responsibility.
Yep.
But the capsule carrying the people.
Yeah.
That's a big deal.
Yeah. It's a lot longer mission from that standpoint. You know, when you're on the propulsion side, you get them to space and then the mission starts for the crew. It's all critical, right? I mean, it's all very much, we're synced and integrated, very much like the shuttle days in terms of the way the teams have to work together, and we have to know what each other are doing from a system standpoint. But we're very excited. This is a great opportunity for us, and I think we're gonna bring the American public with us as we go back to the moon. I can't wait to see the pictures and hear the crew as they talk about it when they're circling the moon.
Yeah, and of course the mission after that. A lot has to be done before Artemis III, where astronauts will be on the surface of the moon. Any insight into how that effort is going?
It's going well. We're on our end. Like I said, we've got the Orion capsule is made into the service module. Artemis 2, 3, and 4 are all in build. The Orion capsules are all in build at different stages. So we're excited. We're ready to go execute this mission for NASA.
Okay, you and I chatted just a little bit about the whole idea of commercial space flight, and you said that it's really more a commercial approach to space flight. Can you talk about what that means?
Yeah, I think it really depends on the acquisition.
Yeah.
The way that the government chooses to acquire is really what drives that approach, right? And so we've been involved with both. From a Lockheed Martin standpoint, we'll do the Orion, which is what I would call a more traditional acquisition that NASA would do. But we're also working with Blue Origin on the sustained lunar development. The second lunar lander after the initial one that was awarded. So we can work in both environments. It's really just a matter of recognizing how the government wants to acquire and how we can work together on those processes.
It's safe to say that things, they've always been complex, but it feels more complex just to an outside observer, that having multiple companies like Lockheed Martin working with others, that maybe doesn't make it easier, but it's a better approach maybe than one person or one group trying to do it.
Yeah, I think NASA does a really good job integrating all those pieces. I mean, they do a fantastic job making sure we all know what each other are doing. They have many forums that allow us to have those conversations. I can't just work Orion in a vacuum, no pun intended, right?
Yeah, yeah.
I can't just work Orion in a vacuum. I've got to be working with the other partners that are going to be using that system, or I'm going to be using their system. Obviously, we have a great connection with SLS, tremendous connection actually with that, but we're beginning to work with the other partners as well. What can we bring? Because the advantage is, I'm building systems that keep humans alive for a long time, going to and from. Well, what can we bring to the different missions, the landers, the things like that? That's the advantage of having a multi company kind of team approach that NASA's taken. And the integration is important. It's really important, but I think NASA has the right forums in place to make sure that happens correctly.
Okay, I want to ask you a couple of general NASA questions, but first let's talk about OSIRIS-REx, which, you know, we keep forgetting that we've got stuff from an asteroid, you know, on our planet. Talk about that mission.
Yeah, it was a great mission. You know, we launched it 7 years ago when I was at NASA.
Yeah.
Again, I was on the other side. We went to the asteroid Bennu. We went down and took a sample off of it with a pretty innovative approach that the Lockheed Martin team came up. Did that in the middle of COVID, by the way, so that it was pretty distributed. We were able to use digital twins and technology to practice, even though everybody could be in the same room. As you remember, the mouth of the thing was full, and we had a hard time even closing the door. So we thought we had a pretty good sample. You never know if you get it back.
There was dust on the outside of the collector.
Yeah. So when we brought it back, we brought it back to Utah here about a month ago, I think. And when they opened it up, they're finding stuff everywhere. Yeah. So it's exciting. It's really kind of what NASA's role is, and us as industry is to support those missions. You know, who knows what we're going to learn. If it's like most of the NASA missions that when I was in the agency, especially on the science side, we answer three questions, we create 20 more, right?
Yeah.
And that's why you keep the exploration journey going. And I'm, you know, I think this is a great example of what we're going to learn when we actually do things like the Mars sample return, those kind of issues too.
Okay, so you're a manned spaceflight guy, but really there have been so many incredible things. I remember there was a lot of wailing and gnashing of teeth about the space telescope, and nobody talks about how much it costs now because it's working so well, and you've got the OSIRIS-REx. So, I mean, we've done some incredible things with, I don't know if you're non-human spaceflight. Should we look at it as one big thing and these are different parts of it? Or you know, some people say, well, we should be doing more of this one, or we should be doing more of that one. How do you look at it?
Well, I've always been an and guy, Steve.
Yeah.
It's both. It's human and robotic exploration. That's what allows us to really understand.
Okay.
You can, in my opinion, you can never take the human out of it, the human experience, but the robotic exploration actually helps us learn what we need to do before we take humans into that environment and what's risky. So I think that's an important piece. You know, the technologies and things that we learn in space obviously apply back to other systems that we build that aren't necessarily NASA related. So there's just a lot of synergy between the two, I think. I think it's more synergistic than it is, you know, the and, not the or, right, that people want to do all the time.
And maybe people don't get that so many of the things we learn doing space flight, whatever kind it is, they end up benefiting people who live on Earth, right?
Absolutely, yep.
Okay, a couple of questions, and you may not want to answer these, but I wanted to ask. You know, there's talk of deorbiting the space station at some point, and I don't. Nobody said we're doing it. I don't think, but just as a manned spaceflight guy and involved with the shuttle, I mean, involved with the station. What do you think, or can you talk?
I'll leave that one to NASA. I'm honestly not connected enough anymore, Steve, on that one to know. But they will make the decision, just like I said before, on requirements. What are the requirements? Let's make sure we have the safety of the astronauts in place. NASA's done a good job, I think, setting up a commercial space station kind of program that allows us to still maybe do the kind of things we're doing on space station today. But you know, at some point, they'll have to make the call.
Yeah.
But I trust that. I trust them perfectly on that to make that decision.
And I would expect if whatever commercial that Lockheed would make an effort to get involved with whatever.
Yeah, we're working on technologies and talking to several companies about what we can do. We do some inflatable work that we've been really proud of that our teams have put together. We'll see where it goes.
Okay, so you kind of know more. Well, you do know more about what's coming next.
Mm-hmm.
So when you look at where we are and the things we'd like to do, we know about Artemis 2 and Artemis 3. We know about getting the samples back from Mars. Any kind of timeline that you've seen that you could say, well, Steve, you know, if things go right.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I think I'd be speculating at this
I'm
point in a big way, right?
You know, I think speculate, it's you.
I don't know. I think that, I think there's so many dependencies. That's the challenge, right? There's so many dependencies on funding. There's so many dependencies on some technologies that have to be developed. So it's kind of hard to crystal ball that one. I do know we're making progress. That's the thing. That's the main thing that I look for is what's the trend? Are we going in the right direction? And we are, I think, as a nation, the support is there. So I do see great opportunities as we go forward in that arena. And I also see, I mean, see, there's the other side of my business, which is not the NASA side of the business. The other side of the business is, you know, we've got threats we have to pay attention to as a nation and making sure we're developing the systems that deter. That's really what we want to talk about is deterrence. How can we build those systems for our customers and make sure they're successful so that we, not only are we doing this nice exploration activities that we get to do, whether human or scientific, but we're also deterring and trying to keep peace here on Earth.
Okay, long career in space. Before, when you got to Lockheed and you were seeing the breadth of what you were responsible for, did it surprise you? Did you think, oh, or did you, you kind of knew that stuff?
Well, a little bit of a surprise, mostly on the national security and Department of Defense side of the house. But the people, the focus, you know, as I said, protect, connect, and explore. You can get your head around that pretty quick, right? You want to protect. And the mix, what's interesting about it, Steve, for me, was the mix between what I'll call civilian-type activities versus defense-type activities. Think about protect, okay? Clearly, I'm trying to protect the warfighters, but I'm also trying to protect the astronauts when they come home, make sure they're safe. But I'm also trying to protect the public. I build the GOES satellites, that the weather satellites that we use every day, right? How can I protect, you know, our citizens from natural disasters, those kind of things? So that's just using the protect monitor of protect, connect, and explore, it, where it mixes across security, national security, and civilian activities. It's just the breadth is fascinating. It's fun. It's exciting too, honestly.
And it really does make us a spacefaring nation at this point.
Oh, absolutely, absolutely, no doubt about it. Space is in our lives every day, Steve. I can tell you just a quick story.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. So I spoke once at an event, and we build the GPS satellites.
Yeah.
Right. Use GPS every day. We build those at Lockheed
Using
Martin.
Using it right now.
Yeah. we build those at Lockheed Martin, and so we had just shipped one, and I was speaking at an event, and I said, "Hey, we just shipped a GPS satellite for its next launch," and I said. I was sharing that story with somebody as I walked in. This was a joke. It was my joke to open the speech. I shared that with somebody as I was walking in, and they go, "Why do I need GPS satellites? I have maps on my phone," right? And and about half the room laughed. Yeah. The other half didn't. And I said, "For those of you that didn't laugh, we need to talk after this after this meeting." People don't realize how much they depend on space on a daily basis, and that's what we get to do. We get to make sure. Frankly, I don't want them to worry about depending on it. I want our systems to be there. I want them to be there for warfighter. I want them to be there for the public, and I want them to be there for our NASA astronauts as we go forward. So that's what's exciting to me. That's what gets me going every morning, and just really, really fun time to be involved in space.
All right, Robert Lightfoot, thank you.
All right, thanks, Steve. Good to see you.